Hi folks, this is part 4 of a playlist about the preparation of carboxylic acids. In this video we'll have a look at the oxidation and C-C bond cleavage of alkenes and arenes to carboxylic acids. Such reactions sometimes proceed under surprisingly mild conditions and with amazing selectivities, as I'll show you in a minute. Alkenes can be cleaved by treatment with ozone, and the initially formed ozonides can in fact be cleaved oxidatively to carboxylic acids, either by heating with acids or with hydrogen peroxide. However, ozone isn't always readily available in most laboratories and often too expensive for large-scale preparations. Several more convenient alternatives are available today. Here I've sketched some potential intermediates of such cleavage reactions. These include epoxides, diols, aldehydes, alpha hydroxyketones, and alpha keto acids. Here you have a list with typical reagents for oxidative alkene cleavage. Most of them require transition metal catalysis. Let's check some specific examples. One of the most convenient oxidants is hydrogen peroxide. In combination with tungstate, manganese, or vanadate, many functional groups will be oxidized by this reagent. Here, dotysine was oxidized to undecanoic acid with an excess of hydrogen peroxide, 3% of tungstate, a phase transfer catalyst, and a small amount of phosphoric acid. As shown here, also cinnamates can be cleaved with hydrogen peroxide. The solvent was acetonitrile and the oxidation already proceeded at room temperature. Benzylic or ethyl esters can remain unchanged during such oxidations. Despite the acetic acid and high reaction temperature, no transesterification occurred in this example. It is also possible to oxidize terminal alkenes to alpha-keto acids without C-C bond cleavage. Here, an excess of tertsbutyl hydroperoxide and iron catalysis converted styrene into phenylglyoxylic acid. Sodium periodate is a relatively expensive reagent which generates problematic inorganic waste and can therefore only be used for the preparation of advanced intermediates. On the other hand, it is easy to handle and to dose precisely and enables highly selective oxidations. In this example, enantiomerically enriched fluorbiprofen was prepared by a periodate-mediated olefin cleavage. The oxidation was catalyzed with 2% of ruthenium chloride and proceeded cleanly at room temperature. No oxidation of the phenyl groups occurred. Here the enone substructure of testosterone acetate was cleaved with an excess of periodate. The catalyst was potassium permanganate and the oxidation was complete after 2 hours at 35 degrees Celsius. In this example, a homoallyl amine was first isomerized to an allyl amine by heating with a ruthenium metathesis catalyst. Ruthenium then catalyzed the oxidative C-C double bond cleavage and the oxidation of a sulfenamide to a sulfonamide. No racemization occurred. Also, alkynes can be oxidized and cleaved. Here, a mixture of oxone and 3% of ruthenium oxide brought about complete conversion of the starting alkyne into a carboxylic acid. Partial oxidation of a benzyl ether also occurred, but no beta elimination. Unfortunately, a complex solvent mixture was used, what would be problematic for the scale-up of this reaction. In general, it is preferable to use as few solvents as possible to facilitate their recovery and purification. Let's have a look at the complete oxidation of arenes, for instance phenyl groups, to carboxyl groups. Here's a list with some of the most popular reagents capable of such oxidations. One convenient oxidant is nitric acid, because of its low price and lack of problematic waste streams. Electron-rich arenes can be oxidized completely by nitric acid, as in this example. Here, the oxidation of a substituted 8-hydroxyquinoline was catalyzed by a small amount of manganese dioxide. 8-hydroxyquinolines are readily accessible from 2-aminophenols. The parent unsubstituted quinoline can apparently not be oxidized to pyridine 2,3-dicarboxylic acid with nitric acid alone. With chlorate and copper sulfate, however, even quinoline can be oxidized to a diacid, as shown here. Pyridines are electron-deficient heteroarenes comparable to nitrobenzene and are usually oxidized more slowly than phenyl or benzo groups. Naphthalenes are, like phenols, also electron-rich and easy to oxidize. In this example, a biphasic mixture of 2-bromo-naphthalene, aqueous sodium hypochlorite, 0.5% of ruthenium chloride, and a phase transfer catalyst was stirred at room temperature for only 20 minutes. Mostly the non-brominated benzo group was oxidized to a brominated phthalic acid. Unsubstituted phenyl groups are more difficult to oxidize than naphthalenes or phenols, but will be degraded faster than pyridines. Here, 4-phenylpyridine could be oxidized in fair yield to 4-picolinic acid by treatment with oxone and 5% of a cobalt salt. Today, the most common reagent for small-scale phenyl group oxidations is a mixture of periodate and a ruthenium salt. A representative example is shown here. The reaction conditions were exceedingly mild and gave a high yield of the carboxylic acid. Dialkoxybenzenes are, of course, particularly reactive, but even unsubstituted phenyl groups can be oxidized under these conditions. Unfortunately, though, an inconvenient solvent mixture was used, difficult to separate by distillation and to recycle. It often happens in chemistry that some new but not yet optimized procedure is published, and then everybody slavishly follows exactly this suboptimal procedure, without even considering to improve it. For instance, dicyclohexyl carbodiamide was used for decades, despite its many disadvantages and the availability of superior alternatives. Let's hope that some reckless chemist dares to challenge the status quo, coming up with a better solvent. In this example, a 2-anisyl glucose derivative was oxidized with a large excess of sodium periodate and 6% of ruthenium chloride in the same awful solvent mixture. No oxidation of the carbohydrate occurred, and a high yield of carboxylic acid resulted. Here, the starting material contained a protected amine and acylyl ether, but still, the anisyl group could be oxidized selectively. Here, even an unprotected, highly nucleophilic quinuclidine remained unchanged during oxidation with a huge excess of periodate and catalyst. The yield of carboxylic acid was excellent. This here is an example of quinoline oxidation with ozone. The oxidation proceeded under strongly acidic conditions and gave 2-acetylnicotinic acid as main product. Also, permanganate can convert quinolines into pyridine 2,3 dicarboxylic acids. Here, the low yield was also due to the difficult separation of the product from manganese dioxide and other byproducts. So, what can go wrong? Of course, despite the high selectivity of some of these reagents, there's always the risk that some other functional group may be oxidized too. Then, treatment of arenes with oxidants can yield phenols, quinones, or biaryls. If the target carboxylic acid contains a hydroxyl group, 5- or 6-membered lactones may result instead of the free acid. Amines can be oxidized to nitriles, imines, or amine oxides. Here, a morpholine was dealkylated just by oxidation with air. The electron-rich phenyl group remained unchanged. In this example, instead of oxidation of the activated electron-rich aryl groups, dearylation and formation of a lactone occurred. It is not clear if treatment of this starting material with periodate and ruthenium chloride would have yielded a carboxylic acid. Here are some further references, which you can also find in the description of this video. For subscribers, there's a PDF version of this presentation under the Community tab. The next video of this playlist is about the carboxylation of various carbon nucleophiles with carbon dioxide. See you then!